Have you heard the story? The Christ is finally here. He's at the edge of the city. Let's run. I've just gotta be near him. All the people are shouting. They've come just to see their king. Tell the daughter of Zion, rejoice, for we've been redeemed. He is riding victorious, like the prophets foretold. Visions are glorious, we must bow down before him. Lay our hearts and souls before him. Lord of all, Lord of all, Hosanna, Hosanna. See him ride in majesty. Hosanna, Hosanna, Lord of all eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, raise your hands in victory. Hosanna, Hosanna, he's come to set his people free. Behold your salvation, he comes to the willing heart. Blessed over all nations, his love will never depart. Now he's reigning victorious, forever he is Lord, he is Lord. Christ has delivered us, we must fall down before him. Lay our hearts and souls before him. Lord of all, Lord of all, Hosanna, Hosanna. See him reign in majesty. Hosanna, Hosanna, Lord of all eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, raise your hands in victory. Hosanna, Hosanna, he's come to set his people free. Hosanna, Hosanna, see him reign in majesty. Hosanna, Hosanna, Lord of all eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, raise your hands in victory. Hosanna, Hosanna, he's come to set his people free. He's come to set his people free. He's come to set his people free.
A.W. Tozer once said, "The most important fact about any human being is what they believe about God." That's why corporate worship centered on the Word of God is so important. And that's probably the reason we miss it so much when we're in times like this, when we can't get together for corporate worship. But while all of creation is a powerful reflection of God's general revelation, His Word is His specific revelation to us. That's why the Word is so important as the centerpiece of all of Christian worship. In his book on worship, Look and See, singer-songwriter Matt Papa says, "The triune God is the only thing large enough and interesting enough to bear the weight of glory and ultimately worship. Anything else will break your heart. So then money isn't secure enough. Entertainment isn't impressive enough. Music isn't interesting enough. Food isn't satisfying enough. People aren't reliable enough. The world isn't good enough. Creation isn't permanent enough. So only God, the highest and the greatest good, the infinite Holy One, is the only one fully enough. And the one worthy of our praise and adoration. Nothing can bear the weight of your worship other than Jesus Christ himself." Now, as we consider today the triumphal entry of Jesus on Palm Sunday, Through the biblical passages of Matthew 21 and Psalm 118, we get a glimpse into the heart and the character of God. Let us savor those scenes as we read them, as we look over them, and as we meditate on them, and imagine the sounds of the people lining the road of the procession as they waved their palm branches in anticipation of Jesus passing by. Just days later, some of them would weep as they witnessed the cruelty toward Jesus. And yet others of them would change their shouts of Hosanna to cries of crucify him. But when we reflect on that, may we be steadfast in our praise of the one who died for us. Now, on this Sunday, we remember and we celebrate the Lord's triumphal entry into Jerusalem. The people shouted their praise to the Lord as he rode on the donkey that day. But the people of God have always been encouraged through the word to give the Lord praise and thanks for who he is. He is the creator. He is the redeemer. He is all that we have. And as the psalmist writes in Psalm 118:1, give thanks to the Lord for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Let Israel say, his faithful love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his faithful love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his faithful love endures forever. In the opening hymn of our worship today, we are reminded to rejoice because the Lord is King. And as the second verse is sung, don't miss the words and how they connect to what Psalm 118 records. And that's what guides our worship. It reads, Jesus the Savior reigns, the God of truth and love. We can trust in this day that Jesus is reigning now, even in this time of difficulty and uncharted waters, and that he will continue to reign. And we can also be assured that his love will endure forever.
Thank you.
On the day of his triumphal entry, many people who lined the road in praise had heard of the incredible miracles and had heard of the mighty works Jesus had performed. Some of them may have been the direct recipient of much of his healing touch. They were looking for a deliverer. They were searching for a promised Messiah, one who would answer them in their distresses. And in Psalm 118, the writer is clear in expressing his trust in the Lord. Listen to these words. I called to the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and put me in a spacious place. The Lord is for me. I will not be afraid. What can a mere mortal do to me? It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in humanity. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in nobles. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. And these scriptures should prompt us to prayer and to thanksgiving and to praise and adoration to our Lord for who He is. These verses of scripture should prompt us to prayer. And maybe we would think of that prayer in three different sections. First of all, confession. You know, as we face this time, through the distress of this time, and through all of the uncertainties with which we're all dealing at this time, have we really called on the Lord? Have we spent the time necessary in prayer, in requesting, in confessing that He might meet our needs? Perhaps in this stress, it might be that our responses to others may not have been as kind and as gracious as they should have been. Or maybe we have not thanked Him enough for His protection of us and for His placing us in the spacious place. Maybe we need to confess our fear of things and that we cannot control and admit that we have lost control of the things we can control. And the responses to others, our response to our circumstances, our response to our own emotions come into play here. We need to be mindful that we need to be in a confession mode so that God can hear us and bless us. Perhaps the second section might be for thanksgiving. We thank God for His Son, for Jesus Christ, the one in whom we have our salvation and our strength and our witness, and the one who places in our hearts the songs of thanksgiving and praise and adoration. Perhaps it would be a time for us to thank God for hearing our prayers. He does hear them, and He does answer them. Maybe it's a time when we need to thank the Lord for knowing the details of every aspect of our lives. Nothing happens to us that He doesn't already know and for which He already has a plan. Perhaps it's a time when we need to thank God for answers to prayer that we've already seen through difficulties and through these specific days of difficulty and uneasiness. And then lastly, we need to make our petitions known to God. We pray for those who've lost their jobs because of the economic impact of COVID-19, that they would seek and find refuge and help in the Lord. We pray for those who have lost loved ones and friends, that they would find their strength and their hope and their peace in the Lord. We pray that many would come to know Christ through this difficult time, through the faithful witness of Christians who model trusting in the Lord and finding refuge in Him, as the scripture says. We pray for wisdom for our government officials. There should not be a day goes by that we do not pray for our president and our vice president and their families and all of those who hold offices of leadership and decision-making in our government. We pray for strength. We pray for stamina and protection for healthcare workers, for doctors and nurses, those who were on the front lines, meeting all of the places where they could receive the virus. We pray for our churches. We pray for pastors and leaders and members, and pray that God would lead us and guide us and shepherd us as we go through this time. And when we pray with the knowledge, the understanding that God not only hears our prayers, but He knows our circumstances in much greater detail than even we know them. He is indeed great, and He is faithful.
Thank you.
been reminded of God's faithful love for us throughout this entire time of worship, throughout this time that we have spent together contemplating and looking at the triumphant entry of Christ into Jerusalem. And as we read the Palm Sunday passage, let's not miss the faithful love that compelled Jesus to ride into Jerusalem with the full knowledge that each step took him closer and closer to the cross. Now, when they approached Jerusalem, according to Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 10, when they approached Jerusalem, they came through Bethphage at the Mount of Olives. And it was at that point that Jesus sent two disciples, telling them, "Go into the village ahead of you. At once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once." This took place so that what was spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled. The prophet wrote, "Tell daughter Zion, see your king is coming to you, gentle and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Now the disciples went and did just as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt. Then they laid their clothes on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their clothes on the road. Others were cutting branches from the trees and spreading them on the road. Then the crowds who went ahead of him and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna to the highest." And then when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in an uproar. Their question was, "Who is this?" And just beneath the crowd's celebration and their waving of palm branches, hailing him as the Blessed One, was the reality of his soon coming agony. The weight of the sin of the world, the wrath of God that would be placed on him. And as we read this account in Matthew, the passage closes in verse 10 with these words. When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in an uproar saying, "Who is this?" As followers of Christ, we have the joy, we have the privilege, we have the knowledge of knowing exactly who he is and what he did for us. May it be that he would indeed draw closer to Jesus and be more aware each day of who he is and what he has done on our behalf. May that be the desire of our heart. And as we close with some of the final verses of Psalm 118, listen to how closely they resemble the passage we read in Matthew. Lord, save us. Lord, please grant us success. He who comes in the name of the Lord is blessed. You are my God, and I will give you thanks. You are my God, I will exalt thee. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, through Christ Jesus, you are our God, and we give you thanks today. As we walk through this coming week, we trust in you and you alone because we know that your faithful love endures forever. Help our belief in that truth impact of our behavior. Let it make us become more of who you would have us to be. And may you be glorified as your Spirit empowers us to live our lives in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And may we celebrate at this time not only your death and your burial for us, but the glorious resurrection and ascension. In Christ's perfect and holy name we pray. Amen.